So I brought my julmust, very clear julmust today, but this is my way to keep going. Right, so you probably all know about this and have heard about it before, that data is becoming the most valuable asset you all have. And if you believe in McKinsey and team, that those of you that are already at forefront here, the early adopters, you'll double your cash flow if you take care about the data assets you have today. If you don't, then you'll be the laggards tomorrow or a few years from now. But are companies today like taking care of the data as the valuable asset that it is? This is in Swedish. Maybe not all of them know, or all of you know how or can read this. But is it quite recent where it's a couple of million patient calls to one of the so healthcare services here in Sweden, that they were openly available on the internet. So data can be lost either by complex vendor chains or by incompetency. In this case, it was both, I guess. But data is also very actively targeted. So also in this like collection or roundup of the biggest data breaches, data leaks. So even here we have Sweden. Let's see if this works. Can I? Yeah. Here we have an honorary mention of Swedish Transport Agency, which was one of the most interesting data leaks now in 2018. So they have it's yellow. They have a very interesting story behind it. So in similar league like the Mossack Fonseca break and the Equifax data leak. So good company there. And this is also important. So data is very actively targeted. If it's not actively targeted in your organizations today, like maybe you don't just know about it, but probably it is. So if data is this important, and at the same time we also use data for machine learning, so how do we leverage AI and machine learning, but at the same time keep control of our data? So today I'm here to give just a short introduction to federated learning. So federated learning makes it possible to build machine learning systems where you don't move the training data. So you keep the training data in place, you don't move that, but you still are able to build machine learning systems. So my name is Daniel. So I'm the CEO and one of the co-founders of Scaleout, which is a company which originally based out of several research teams in Uppsala and Uppsala University, where we've been putting machine learning into production for several years now. So today we are mostly focused on helping companies get machine learning into production, so from data models to production, really. And we also do help some expert help in cloud native deployments, but mostly focused on deploying machine learning. I also love to talk about machine learning, how to get value out of machine learning. So we are here together with Dardax. Like maybe you heard Henrik Jötberg this morning, the chairman here. So we have formed an alliance of enterprises and expert teams like us that are working together to create frameworks and to adopt machine learning best practices, really, and frameworks in large enterprises. So come talk more with us, also around other things except outside of Fed Learning or more in depth about Fed Learning. All right, so going back one step, standard machine learning, the current paradigm, how most of you do it. You have a number of different data stores. 1, 2, 3, this data is separated in different places. Most data management practices is built around centralizing this, all of this data into a central data store, your data warehouse, clean up all the data, have control over it, then create one machine learning model, and the end users do queries, get predictions back. So, pretty simple in concept. However, now, what if we cannot move the data? Then this model breaks down immediately, right? So because machine learning is dependent on getting as much data together as possible, but very often data cannot be moved from its source. So we have these three big standard cases, like First one, you have private or proprietary data. Hey, I don't want to move my data. My data is too sensitive. I don't want to send it to the cloud or someone else. Second big case is regulated data, like healthcare data or GDPR data, where it's very, very complex from a regulatory point of view to move data, especially if you move it to others. And last case is actually big data. It's just too big. It's too complex, too costly to move around. In all of these cases, this standard case where you centralize all the data breaks down. So now you cannot do machine learning anymore. Or? So how can we instead collaborate in organizations and between organizations on building machine learning models without giving up ownership of the data? So which is essentially what I was describing here. So the concept is pretty clear with federated machine learning now. You start here, number one. What you do is you keep your data local. So you have one data store, and you create one local machine learning model. You train one local machine learning model on this data store. And then the federated part is that instead you somehow aggregate these local machine learning models, and you make predictions on a global model. Now, all of this, there are many different ways to do this. So this is just one example. And this is one of the more used ones, where you have a system where you have a local model, you have a global model, and you train local model. These local models are aggregated into a global model. This global model is then sent back out to these local systems. So that's one iteration, and then you train it on local data again, and then you make another iteration again, over and over again. So that's one approach. You could say like this is also a very, very new field. This is bleeding edge research in many cases. It's not yet operationalized, and there are no off-the-shelf solutions really to do this. It's really came to fame in 2017 with Google publishing a paper on it was based on doing predictions on their keyboards on smartphones. So and before that, very, very little research was published. But that really kicked it off. Today, Google and Samsung are both doing a lot of work in the smartphone area. So we are doing some work, and there are a couple of others also doing work in other areas. But it's still very much a research field. So this is just now explaining. So we were calling it privacy-preserving machine learning. Federated learning is one of these. The key here is that we have data. So first question, so how do we, when do we know if it's appropriate to apply a federated learning model? We start by asking ourselves, if it's okay to share the data. If it is, yes. Do the standard machine learning models that you all know. Like, that's the base case, that's what you should do first. Maybe it's not possible to share the data, but you can share features, okay. If you can do that, you're back to the base case. However, if you're not able to share data or share features, then you get into this much more interesting area. And this is also where you get already different kind of methods. So starting off, can you do this aggregated models, so where you actually send models back and forth? Then you are here, you can create joint models. So that's like one big family of methods. But there are also other methods that where you share even less like information. And if you're in this case where you want to protect your keep data as private as possible, then you can even be in these cases. So our last slide will be an example of that, which we are working on. Now also. So the key promise here of federated machine learning now is to be able to join forces, we call it in alliances, where you're able to build a better machine learning model than any other member or any member in this alliance would be able to do by themselves. So we have an example is work from Andreas, who is our research leader, also working at the university in Uppsala as associate professor. So some of the work that is in preparation right now, where we're trying to explain these situations and when these methods are appropriate. So here's one example, or as an illustration, where this score is how well this system classifies the digits data set. So digits is a standard machine learning data set for image recognition of written numbers. So the score is how well does this one predict the test set. Now, what we are doing is that we take this standard digits test set, we break it up, so we break up the training data in smaller chunks. And you see, so we're looking at where does this, the standard model, which is like the green one, that's the mean model, when do when does this model start to break down? So somewhere here around like an alliance, when you divide this data into 8 or 16 chunks, the normal kind of machine learning model is not really appropriate anymore, because if someone else were able to do an alliance, get more data together, or make an alliance where you don't share data but you collaborate on a machine learning model, they would have a machine learning model that is has much higher power than your model. And like this is in a business situation very significant, because so if your competitor has access to a machine learning model with a score here in this case of like 0.95 and you are here at 0.8, you get it wrong 20% of the time, while your competitor is right 95% of the time. That has real impact. So how is this always like this? No, it's not. So this is very much a function of the problem at hand, the data you have, the distribution of data between alliance members, and also the methods that you're working with. So therefore, like, you cannot guess what kind of federated machine learning solution you should have. Instead, talk to someone that has some experience in this field, like, and we can work this out together, right? And now, since we're talking about data privacy, I also want to mention two other concepts that you can put on top of this to further like increase the privacy of your system. So first one is differential privacy, which is something that you add noise to your data, so that here your first machine learning models, it's much harder to do inference attacks or to read out data. So by doing queries, you make it much harder to understand what data went into this model. The other one that you can use as well is homomorphic encryption, where actually what you do is all these methods that you have that aggregate the machine learning models, everything is done on encrypted data all the way. So the calculations are done on encrypted data. It never goes into clear text. However, homomorphic encryption is not really feasible to do like in production systems today. It's also another like very complex area to put on top of things. Now you have this broad concept and you think, okay, so let's put this into production. So the fun and easy part always is to be the data scientist, you play around with your data, you do model and test. So that's fine. But just the normal case here of getting a real production-ready pipeline that goes from your data, and which is an iterative process in itself, and then is able to pull these machine learning models all the way out to serving end users, that's a complex situation in itself. So which is one of the things that we are working on today. So that's, but when you add federated machine learning on top of this, it becomes much like even worse, because now you have to create one machine learning pipeline on each site or in each organization. On top of each of these, you need to have communication so they can communicate with each other. And on top of this, you have all of these federated components. So how this model communication, you have to get the information in and out about the model and prediction itself, anomaly detection or to detect adversarial behavior and other things. And you also need a system to serve this global to end users. So also having this in mind now, so this makes it very clear that federated machine learning is not the same as distributed machine learning. So where distributed machine learning is just a way to speed up your training process by leveraging parallel computing. So that's a totally different thing. So I just have that clear in mind. So what we're doing now is that we're working very, very hard now to bridge the gap. So between federated machine learning in the research field or research area, and how do we get this into production ready systems. So we're like building this process so it works with federated machine learning systems. And so this is a very, very, we have a few minutes left, and this was a very, very broad introduction. So what I want to do now is like highlight how to go further on from here. So number one, go home, read about federated learning. It's really interesting. It's good stuff. It's interesting and it has many uses. Like, and to find uses like in your own organizations, that would be great. Two is that we have next Friday coming up at the General or GE Testa Center. We have a workshop demo where we go much deeper into this using one of the methods that is in this family called non-disclosive conformal prediction. So where we've built one of the systems we have. So this is a very privacy-preserving version or method here, in that it never shares models, it only discloses a prediction and a confidence interval in this prediction, and then you can do that in one alliance. And this system that we have, it was developed actually by this guy, Ola Spjut, together with the pharma industry to predict toxicity in drug candidates. But this demo is being done, will be done by Andreas. Andreas is here. We are here today, so we'd love to talk more to you about this. However, Ola is also here, but he will be here tomorrow. And then he will give a talk about his lab that he's built, that is an automated lab for, and very robotized also, lab for drug discovery that does a lot of high throughput analysis and machine learning. So 11:15 tomorrow. And I think that was like exactly 18 minutes, which...
Almost 18 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you so much.